everybody. This is Tippy.
And this is Jo.
And you're listening to the Tippy Jo Show, sponsored by BetterHelp.com/the barn. If it's all right, I want to kick it with you all night, all night. Have a good time. We will. Ain't got to worry because it's all right. It's all right. Well, let's talk a little bit about mental health.
That's exactly what I was going to talk about.
Oh, and microdosing.
Oh, I wasn't going to talk about that.
Oh, have we talked about microdosing before?
No.
Nice. So, have you heard of microdosing?
Microdosing
for
what?
Mushrooms. Shrooms.
Okay.
Have you heard? I have heard of it.
For mental health reasons.
Yes.
Okay. So, it's been studied, and they've found that microdosing shrooms helps people to overcome their PTSD, anxiety, depression. Like, it's basically like a reset for your brain, which I find extremely interesting.
Well, yeah.
We watched a documentary about it on Netflix, learned a lot about
it. What was it called?
It was
specifically about psychedelics.
Oh, it was, yeah. Man. That's a good question.
It was like during COVID. It was one of those just random documentaries.
Something in your mind.
Open your mind
open
or
your
explore
mind,
your mind.
Something like that, yeah.
Expand your mind.
But it was really good.
It
man,
good.
Watching that.
Made you want to do drugs.
It did make you want to do drugs, you know? Everything was so happy and brightly colored on that show.
Oh my gosh.
So it was like,
you should have been on drugs while you were watching.
Right? That's too funny. Have you ever done shrooms?
No.
You ever microdosed? Obviously not. If you've
obviously
never done shrooms,
no.
Yeah.
I never have because I'm just afraid they're going to taste gross because they look
gross. Well, they taste like mushrooms, but some people like...
No, I don't like that.
Either put them on chocolate and eat them, or they'll like mix them into things and eat them.
One of my buddies told me if I was going to do it, I should put them into a capsule, that was the best
way. Oh, yeah, you can do that. Grind them up, put them in a capsule, then you don't even have to taste them at all.
I just feel like if I wanted to do mushrooms, I would have a hard time eating them.
You're so funny.
I'm like, bleh.
You are very picky, so I could totally see how you would have a hard time eating mushrooms. Yeah.
What about you?
Well, yes. I've done shrooms a couple of times in my life now. I would say 3 to be exact. One of them being today, earlier today, actually. Yeah. So I have been struggling with my mental health for the past... Well, my whole life. However, really been in it for like a month now, I guess I would say it. I just been having a hard time, you know, like I don't want to be here anymore. Like if there were a reset button, I'd fucking smash that shit because I'm just not having a great time up here in the brain. So today I was like, man, I got to do something. Like I am just like out of my mind, like depressed, like I'm not having a great time and I'm tired of feeling this way. Then I remembered, oh, yeah, we bought some shrooms and they've just been sitting in my room just waiting for me to eat them. And so today I was like, you know what? Let me just eat a small dose and then go to work and work with the public and see how that works out. So I thought I was taking just a little dose that like wouldn't do anything at all, you know, just kind of like give me that little sense of euphoria that I'm looking for, you know. And yeah, ate 2 little caps. And then my whole body vibrated for a while. It was a interesting experience, to say the least.
So how did it make you feel mentally? Did it help?
I think it did, actually.
Yeah? Took away some of the anxiety?
It did. Not at first. So at first, whenever it kicked in, like, I didn't even realize what was happening, right? So I had one earbud in and I was listening to a book. And then I also had the TV on. It had music playing for the store, right? And then all of a sudden, I got extremely overstimulated. And like the music happening and the book happening, like people talking to my ear at the same time was like way too fucking much. And I had to take my earbud out and set it down. And then I was like, whoa.
The walls are melting.
I was like, this is not a good time. And then I started getting anxiety about what if it's a bad trip, you know? I think that like you should definitely be like closely monitored.
That's what scares me with shrooms. Bad trip.
Bad trips?
Yeah.
That's what I feel like. I'm going into it, I would be nervous already.
Yeah.
And I feel like that would cause me to have a bad trip.
But I believe that's why they always say to make sure you only do that, especially the first time, with your calm person. Someone yeah. that you feel safe and secure around.
Somebody
and
that can remind like, you that, like,
this bitch would be good to deal with because she's going to make sure nothing happens to you.
I'll babysit you guys. Don't you worry. Don't you worry your little hearts. I'll be right here for you.
Like, so, you know my imagination. Come on.
So maybe the trick behind the micro-dosing mushrooms. The trick behind micro-dosing mushrooms is that maybe it makes you feel so much anxiety while you're on them that once you're done with that, you're like, fuck, at least I don't have that kind of anxiety right now.
Well, the first time I did them, I was young. I was a teenager in high school, and I was at a friend's house, and she had some, and we put them on chocolate bars, ate them that way. Couldn't really taste them, you know? And then we went laser bowling.
Which you're like, this ain't gonna do shit, oh.
That was a great time. And I only felt euphoria. I was so happy. I was carefree. I didn't eat enough to where I was, like, hallucinating or anything. So it was just, like, a nice, like, good vibes, good time. You know, like, it's not, I wasn't, like, separate from my mind or anything. Like, I had my wits about me. I was completely okay. I was just, like, in a euphoric state. I just felt good, you know? And, well, I mean, the lights were a lot prettier. Everything gets a little more vivid whenever you do any kind of psychedelics. Just gets a little more vivid. So that was a good time, right? And then the second time I did them was not that long ago either. This, I mean, it was this year, last year?
Yeah.
This year. Yeah. And I, once again, I was just having a terrible fucking time in my brain, you know? And I was like, I'm going to fucking eat these and see what happens. And I ate like, so I had 1 gram, and they say like half a gram to 1 gram is like enough for one person. So I was like, well, I don't want to do a whole gram because I don't want to, I'm not trying to trip or nothing. I'm just trying to get a little,
feel good and
get
happy
a little happier. And, you know what I mean? So I ate a quarter gram, right? And then nothing happened. So then I ate the other quarter. So that, you know, put me at a half gram and still nothing happened. And I was like, okay. I mean, it didn't go bad. It didn't go good. It was just like, I didn't really feel anything. So fast forward to today. Then I was like, let me go ahead and eat these 2 caps here. Surely it's not going to do anything. But yeah, it was weird. It made my body vibrate.
Well, was it comfortable or not comfortable?
Well, at first it wasn't comfortable. At first it wasn't because, I don't know, I guess because I wasn't prepared for it to happen. Like, I knew that I had taken them, but I thought that I had only taken enough that it would just kind of boost my mood a little, you know? I wasn't anticipating that I had taken enough for it to kind of like
heighten all of your senses.
Yeah, I guess. And like when it started to kick in, I just wasn't prepared for it. And it really just like overstimulated me, overwhelmed me. And
like,
it just,
do you think that's good for someone that gets overstimulated in the first place?
I do, actually, yes. Yeah. Because I mean, the research shows that it's been proven to help like veterans who come back from war who have like extreme PTSD and like extreme depression. Like, they have given them microdoses, like studied them over time with the microdosing, and it has reset their brains. Like, they get completely cured.
Yeah. Well, that's amazing.
It is incredible. And it's a great tool, you know, if it's used properly. I just wish.
Still illegal though, so.
Oh, we're it not, is. We're not, and that's really stupid. No, go ahead
years,
and do it.
In a few years, they'll be legal. I'm condoning believe. It. They'll be the next.
Is it legal in some states?
Yeah. I think Colorado has started the process of legalizing.
Yeah. Oh, and I've been seeing in my feed a lot of ketamine. Like, ketamine is legal in some places. And there's this ad I keep seeing online, which I always thought ketamine was like a hardcore drug. I don't really know much about ketamine at all, but I've always heard of it to be like, you know, a drug. You know what I mean? But like, it was in my Facebook feed, like this company, just like online medical marijuana and shit like that. Like, this company is like pushing ketamine for anxiety and depression and OCD and all that stuff.
What is ketamine?
Ketamine is a drug.
I didn't know. Maybe it was derived from shrooms.
I don't think so. I don't know. Like I said, I don't know much about ketamine. I'd really have to look that up. But I just thought that was wild because what the fuck, you know? Like, that's just so crazy. Okay, ketamine is a dissociative anesthetic, that has some hallucinogenic effects. Ketamine distorts the perception of sight and sound and makes the user feel euphoric.
So, like, lab-created shroom chemical.
Kind of sounds like
it. Yeah.
Yeah, because it's an anesthetic. Street title, cat tranquilizer.
Oh my God.
Cat volume, Jet K, Kit Kat, purple, Special K. All right, I've heard of that one.
Yeah,
you know.
I've heard of Special K, and that's about it. Hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll just way further into the drugs than I am. I've never heard.
I've only heard from it on, like, TV.
It's funny because before Kyle and I got together, he was a real straight-edge kind of guy, real straight-laced.
Thank you to BetterHelp for sponsoring this episode. BetterHelp is the world's largest therapy service, and it's 100% online. With BetterHelp, you can tap into a network of over 30,000 licensed and experienced therapists who can help you with a wide range of issues. To get started, you just answer a few questions about your needs and preferences in therapy. That way, BetterHelp can match you with the right therapist from their network. Then you can talk to your therapist however you feel comfortable, whether it's via text, chat, phone, or video call. You can message your therapist at any time and schedule live sessions when it's convenient for you. If your therapist isn't the right fit for any reason, you can switch to a new therapist at no additional charge. With BetterHelp, you get the same professionalism and quality you expect from in-office therapy, but with a therapist who is custom-picked for you. More scheduling flexibility and at a more affordable price. Get 10% off your first month at betterhelp.com/thebarn. That's betterhelp.com/thebarn. This episode is brought to you by Copper Fox Contrived, located at 361 West Main Street, Park Hills, Missouri. Handmade gifts and wood flowers.
Looking for the perfect venue to host your next unforgettable event? Look no further than the Ashler, located at 316 West Main Street in Park Hills, Missouri. Whether you're planning a dream wedding, organizing a training event, hosting a thrilling trivia night, or even craving the excitement of a live concert, the Ashler is your ultimate destination. With its versatile space and personable host, the Ashler sets the stage for an extraordinary experience. Their dedicated team is there to bring your vision to life, ensuring every detail is flawless and unforgettable. From their stunning decor to their top-notch audio-visual equipment, the Ashler provides the perfect backdrop for your special occasion. Their experienced staff will work with you to create a customized event that exceeds your expectations. Visit theashler.net today to learn more about their exceptional service and reserve your date at the Ashler.
I guarantee you nobody's out there just starting off with acid.
You know, sure there are. No. Sure there
really?
Are.
Yeah. Damn, if y'all out there starting with acid, you need to calm it down a scotch.
That's the thing.
I don't chase a high. I think it depends on if you have an addictive personality. So if you're somebody who has an addictive personality and you do marijuana, eventually that's not going to be enough for you.
Like
you know what I mean?
Like we've talked about in the beginning episodes, the people that even take marijuana too far. Like
yeah.
Just because I smoke it, like I have standards of etiquette that you should adhere by.
Right.
For one, to not make everybody that smokes weed look like shit.
Right. Yeah.
You know, like it's a, like the town lush that gives everybody a bad name that decides to go drink a beer.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. I don't know. I like smoking a little weed, going out on the town.
But I mean, if you can handle your shit, do what you want.
It's funny, because Tiffany and I are... Oh, shit. Tiffany and I are very different people in that aspect. Like, she wants to smoke a little weed, chill at home. I'm like, I want to smoke weed and go out and talk to people.
Yeah, that's not me. It's so funny, because I'm always, like, scared to be in public if I'm stoned. But if I am stoned and I go out in public, I'm perfectly fine. Mm-hmm. I'm just like, it's the anxiety of thinking about it, like of thinking about being stoned out in the world. It literally doesn't bother me.
I'm probably more obnoxious when I'm sober.
That's so funny. I could see that.
You know what I mean? Because then like I have no fear. Like I'm not drunk or nothing. Do I look like a fool? Yeah, but it's honestly me. I don't need no marijuana for this obnoxiousness.
Why do they expect us to get our balloons filled? Right?
We're having a shroom party. Any mushroom balloons?
We're trying to have a good time over here, okay? Jeez. No, it was an interesting experience today, though, mm-hmm. to say the least.
So would you recommend?
I would absolutely recommend. And I know that I say that I had a hard time in the beginning, like when it started to set in. But I think if I would have been in a different setting, you know, and if I wouldn't have forgotten what I had done, you know, like I think it was just like unexpected. Like I just wasn't.
Once you got to collect yourself, you were just fine.
So once it set in, once it hit me, you know, then I was like, man, I got to go pee. Open the bathroom, realize I was out of toilet paper at work. And I was like, fuck. And I was like, okay, I'm going to go get some toilet paper from the house because we live close by. And then I was like, oh, shit, I forgot to get toilet paper for the house. And then I was like, I'm going to have to go to Walmart. And then I was like, I cannot drive to Walmart.
I think there's some upstairs.
I went to my house and I laid down for a minute. And I was like, I'll just lay here for a minute. If I need to take a nap through lunch, it'll be okay. So I laid there and like my whole body was like vibrating. But I didn't realize it was vibrating and buzzing until it would stop, because it would like come in waves. Oh, and then it would stop abruptly. Okay.
She's giving me a panic attack. It was like explaining this right now.
So I was laying there, right? And it was like, I didn't realize I was feeling this feeling, and then it would stop. And I was like, whoa. And then it was like a jolt, you know what I mean? Because it was like such a sudden stop of this feeling that I was having. And I was like, this is strange.
This bitch having the psychedelic pleasure pulsations.
It was crazy. That's what it was like, you know? But at first it was freaking me out a little, you know? And then I sat up and like I looked in the mirror and I was like, all right, bitch. Like,
get your shit straight.
Like, this is just the negativity being pulled out of your body.
Yes.
I had to get a little hippie with it. You know what I mean? I was like, this is the negativity going away and the positive energy being pulled into you. It's okay.
Now that I might enjoy though.
And then
a little microdose of shrooms and then to meditate. Mm-hmm. I could see that being very fulfilling.
Yes.
It's funny because she said she went to the bathroom and I opened the door and I thought she'd come back and there was a fucking dragon in there.
Not shit my pants. Then realized we have no toilet paper. Oh gosh. No, but they say if you're gonna do it like if you're doing it for like a reset of your brain, microdosing is great. But you can also just trip real hard one time.
Oh my God.
And it will get rid of your depression and anxiety for months. Like actual months. Which is so fucking cool. That's a neat thing.
I would see how it'd be helpful to some people.
Yeah.
Like when pharmaceuticals. It's doing the same thing.
Like when what?
Pharmaceuticals. They're doing the same thing.
But it's healthier because it's literally of the earth.
Yeah.
That's the thing. I wish I didn't have to take pharmaceuticals, you know? I was going to say I wish I didn't have to take drugs.
Like a lot of them do help. Like they were made for a reason. They do work.
Yeah, and it's, you know, it's just that the side effects, it's when you get into, first of all, none of the pharmaceuticals are great for your body. You know, it's damaging to your liver and your kidneys and your heart and all your other fucking organs, you know? And over time, obviously, that shit ain't great. But whenever you get into these, oh, now you need this medicine because this one gives you a side effect.
Yep.
And then they say, oh, well, you're having a side effect from this new one, so you need this medicine.
Or you built the tolerance. We're going to need to try something else.
Yes.
So you need some more.
It just gets crazy. And then at the end of the day, you're having a handful of pills. And like, I'm not trying to do that shit, you know?
It goes into the common conspiracy about how nothing has to be natural.
Let me microdose and give me some weed.
All the natural medicine.
Yeah.
Like, we're supposed to eat dandelions and shit.
Those are good for you.
Yeah, like a superfood.
Say, but yes. I'm like, eh.
I've
like
had dandelion jelly.
In your yard, you can pick. You're like, eh.
Yeah, you can make dandelion tea. I've had dandelion jelly. Oh, it's so good.
I've seen the down south. They fry them.
Mm. Ooh,
powder them and fry them.
I would try that.
I would totally try that.
We should try that. They're like, let's take this healthy thing, deep fried, make it unhealthy.
Or they like just dehydrate them, and then it becomes. Then they make the powder.
Oh. Mm.
So then they can make the tea. Like, that's another way they make the tea.
You guys heard it here first. Throw away your pharmaceuticals, smoke weed, do mushrooms,
snort
dandelions.
There you go. I don't know if you just snort the dandelions.
I wouldn't recommend snorting anything.
Okay. It's funny that you brought up mushrooms, because that's what I wasn't going to talk about mushrooms, but I was going to talk about, like, depression. And, like, I feel like everybody at some point in life deals with depression and anxiety.
Sure.
And I was just curious how you guys deal with that, and clearly Tiffany does mushrooms.
I'm an escapist. Like, I am really bad about whenever I start to get into like a depression, whenever I start to kind of get into my down, you know, I've got cycles. I stay on a high, but when I dip down, sometimes I dip down pretty low, and I avoid. Yeah. I just avoid life.
So you just avoid it?
I avoid life. Like, I like isolate myself. Like, I don't talk to people, and like, I just want to be alone, and like, I don't.
Oh, that means, you know, I should bug you more. That's all that means. You need a bitch that just shows up at your house.
Yeah.
I feel like I try to, like, when I'm going through a depressive episode, I come up with crazy shit. and I try to occupy my mind. I like, this is a new business idea and I'm going to run with it.
Oh boy.
So that's why I've got so many business ideas.
He's like, I'm just so sad all the fucking time.
Well, what I do is I sit on the ground and then I cross my legs. And then what I will do is I roll all the way back. Okay, I stretch my body.
Oh, yeah.
If I'm depressed, that's just what I do.
That seems like the healthiest.
I don't put it off. I think about it.
I'm like, I avoid the world. She's
and
like,
then
I stretch.
I'm usually able to make whatever's making me depressed or more stressed smaller.
Mm-hmm.
Because usually it is smaller than what you're making it out to be in your mind.
Yeah.
And then you think back of all the other times you've been stressed or something's been happening and you made it through that. So then you know the state you're in is temporary. So therefore, you don't focus more on you're depressed. You have to stay depressed and you.
Right.
It's done.
That is one thing.
I don't avoid it.
Yeah.
I definitely feel like I do think about it. I'm like, all right, I can get through this. Like I made it through this before. But like I said, I find things I'll super hyper focus on something.
But then it depends also like what kind of depression the person. Like I don't have clinical depression.
Oh, I do.
Yeah, I just
I've got the good
basic
kind.
Moral of
sadness.
I have anxiety.
You just got like regular
you
people
know, I
sadness.
Have extreme anxiety.
Yeah,
not the depression part of it.
I get both. I'm a real winner
because I feel like if I'm depressed, I made myself depressed with my anxiety by closing off.
Oh, not me. Sometimes I'm just like, the world is sad.
Oh, well, yeah. The world is
just
very
like
sad.
My whole world. You know what I mean? Sometimes I'm just like, everything is shit.
Like it goes into form when people are complaining about certain things or we see stuff in the press or celebrities and like, you know, the people that are self-aware and self-aware of the world around them, like it's shitty. And most of us that acknowledge it's shitty, but we still sit here and do nothing about it because what the fuck are we going to do?
Well,
but is our, I don't feel
well,
like.
Well, we do stuff. We do things small with the community. We try to make them happy.
Yeah.
Like we work at where we can. But whenever you see like the Oprah Winfrey and The Rock putting out the thing, oh, get money and it's going to go into this fundraiser with these entertainment industry or whatever. And people are like, what the fuck? So you're filtering the money into an industry to basically get them more money.
Oh,
and then you decide what the money's going to go towards rather than just directly paying the people. And all the good people were like, no, we're going to set it up and directly pay the people. Just like y'all bitch about Elon Musk. But Elon Musk went and made sure the motherfuckers
like
have
Musk.
Wi-Fi so they can continue connecting with
so
each other to get that money to the
get
people.
Our money.
I'm
My
just
thing
saying.
Is, I don't watch news. I don't watch hardly any TV.
It'll make you depressed.
I avoid it because my thing is, whatever's going on in the overall world, like, I like to focus on my little world right
because
here,
that's all
right
we'll pretty
that's
much see of in
I
our
can
lives.
Affect.
So,
yeah.
So. I'm
try not to add to the problems of the world, but like we can't fix
exactly,
them.
Exactly, yeah. So, but I can, what I can do is I can do something in my local community to make my local community a better place.
Yes. Start small and hopefully it gets bigger.
I'm really big on community stuff.
Yeah.
And I think that's why.
Yeah.
I think you can pretty much tell people who are secretly suffering from depression because I see a trend in people who are sad. They do those things, you know? People who are sad often try to reverse their sadness by making somebody else happy. Like, maybe I can't be happy, but if you are, that's cool.
Yeah, but I don't want you,
know you
to
mean?
Work on making me happy unless it's bringing joy to you. Like, you can't suck your life out to make other people happy
that is a...
and not also making
well,
sure.
Well, yeah, but I think that's not the way that the brain works.
Yeah,
you know
as long
what I mean?
As they're putting into the same you give to them, that's what's important.
You've got to focus on what makes you happy. Like, I feel like happiness is something you truly have to work for. It's not something that's just going to happen. It's not something that you're going to be able to take some mushrooms and make happen. It's something that you have to decide what in your life makes you happy, what in your life makes you depressed, and then you got to cut out those things that make you depressed and do more of those things that make you happy.
Yeah, like
I don't know,
build...
man. I think there's a difference between being circumstantially sad and having depression, you know?
Yeah. Like, and that's why, like, if it's clinical, you can't do
exactly,
anything about
exactly.
it.
Like, you can try, but that's probably
like,
not going to work.
I don't know if you knew this, but I would literally had agoraphobia for 2 years.
What's agoraphobia?
I didn't
going
leave
outside?
My house.
Oh, okay.
I didn't go grocery shopping. I didn't do shit. Like, one of the reasons I don't have my driver's license, why? I don't know. But when I was like 17 and a half, something in my brain just fucking flipped from where I was normal, just fucking fine, productive, to I didn't want to hang out with anybody. I didn't want to go do anything. Like, whenever she took me to go meet Jeremy, Like, literally, we're driving there, and I just fucking flip out. And I'm like, stop the motherfucking car! And then I'm just like, okay, I'm fine. But, like, Tiffany's like, bitch, I'm gonna beat your ass. What is wrong with you? But that's just the anxiety overflowing that you know you have to fight through it because you don't want nothing out of life. But your brain's telling you this is going to end the fucking world if this happens.
Oh, yeah. That's what I think... It's a battle in your mind, basically.
Oh,
you've just got to make.
Because now really I don't have agoraphobia. I still get it sometimes. I get anxious when I go out. Like, I'm super comfortable at the underground. I went down there. So I'll go there anytime because I'm comfortable there.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Like I said, you have to work for happiness. And I think it's a matter of figuring out what it is that makes you happy.
And then medication does help. I was on medicine. Like, I finally got a doctor. I walked in, told him what was going on with me. And he's like, holy shit. Well, he didn't say holy shit, but his mom suffered from like the same stuff. So he put me on the same medicine that she was on. Within 6 months, my chemical imbalance, whatever it was fixed. I didn't have to be on the medicine anymore. So I've been off the med. I was on it for a year probably, and then I didn't need it anymore.
I feel like I self-medicate with like marijuana, which is probably a horrible thing, but I feel like as a guy, it's, I don't know. It almost seems like there's more of a stigma to it as a man.
Well, they're
like,
marijuana?
No. To like to go in and ask for help and be like, hey, I've got depression.
I think
anxiety.
It's up to you men to not do that.
I 100% agree. Like, I'm very open about like my feelings and stuff like that. And I think more men should be that way.
I think a lot more men are becoming more.
I think so.
I think that's one of those things where it's our own internalized shame. Mm-hmm. Where nobody's ever going to point at you and laugh and be like, you fucking pussy, you asked for help. Like, that's not going to happen. But for some reason, like, men across the world have it in their mind that like it's going to make them appear weaker, and
like,
people are going to view them differently. Like, nobody is going to do that. Nobody. You know what I mean? But like, that's one of those things where we put the shame on ourselves and we tell ourselves that society will think this. When have you ever personally witnessed that happening to anybody? Because I haven't.
I haven't.
Another big thing, so like this internalized shame that we all put on ourselves for random different things. One thing I noticed as a woman who had a baby. So whenever you have a C-section, a lot of people will tell you that people are going to judge you and say that the birth wasn't real. And then we all learn to be very defensive about our C-sections because other women are going to tell us that our C-sections aren't a valid birth, that we didn't actually give birth. That's not the same thing. We did something different.
I have no
Nobody
children.
Has
I'm like,
ever
bitch, you gotta
said
cut
that.
The fuck out.
But
like,
nobody's ever said that, though, is the thing. It's just like, it's one of those things where people say, oh, somebody's gonna say this.
Oh, yeah.
And it just never happens. That's just like internal shame that we're projecting. Like, we're afraid of these things happening, but they're not going to happen.
That has to come from some old extent, too.
Well, so Tiffany and I have had this conversation a couple times. So I feel like every decision anyone makes is based on two things. Shame or pride.
Yes.
That is what every decision you ever make in your entire life is based on.
Oh, yeah.
So if you can figure out a way to kind of push that shame, and honestly, even the pride, those are two things that probably you don't need. But like every decision I've ever made has been based on what are people going to think? What are people going to say? And I think you've got to get to a point in your life where you don't care.
Yeah.
I feel like that's kind of where marijuana helps me with that.
Yeah.
So.
Just helps you feel more.
More like, I don't care what anybody says. Because, like, I'm in my head about everything. Like, Tiffany hates going to the store with me because I feel like I'm in everybody's way. I never want to be in somebody's way.
I feel like everybody's in my way.
I feel that way as well. And I'm like, I'm being so considerate of everyone, and these motherfuckers are talking in the middle of the aisle.
We've had that conversation, too. Like, whenever you expect people to behave the same way you expect with your respect and social behavior, and they don't, and you're like, what is the malfunction? I don't understand what you're not getting about it.
Yeah.
Kyle's the worst in the store. It drives me
fucking
Tiffany, insane.
Like, so Tiffany is one of the people that I feel like she doesn't have a lot of... In the store, she's very focused. She's hyper-focused on what she needs and how she goes about getting it. Whereas I'm... So she, like, has no idea what is going on.
I'm in my own world a lot.
So she could be like throwing shit into other people's carts.
Oh, whatever. Not even. No.
But like, I'm very like, okay, make sure I'm not in anybody's way. Make sure I stay out of the way. Don't like that kind of thing. And she's just like, I'm going to get what I need and I'm getting the fuck out of here. So.
Yeah. But so like, I could be looking at something and somebody else could be walking up to look at it. And even if I just got there, Kyle would be like, you're in the way, you're in the way. You need to get there. They're trying to look at that. You need to get out of the way. And I'll be like, we're all here for the same fucking reason. Like, we're all looking for something.
But Tiffany is the worst decision maker
I'm
in the
world. Autistic shopper, okay?
She's like, oh my God, 13 different spaghetti sauces? Uh-huh. Which one do I want? And then she'll stare at it for 15 minutes.
Go for the chunky garden. Don't these motherfuckers eat hunts anyway? What'd you decide?
Yeah, I know. He's just making shit up.
Whenever we first got together, we went to pick out sheets. And I walked in, I picked out sheets, and I walked away. She's like, that's it? I was like, yeah, these sheets, they're green. I like green. Good enough. It took me like 5 minutes. She's like, you're not going to look at every sheet in here.
He didn't even look at any. He just reached. He just like, as he's walking towards the kiosk, he reaches
he
and grabs
knew
sheet.
From far
like,
away.
How do you even fucking know what size those are?
What he wants immediately.
As I walked up, it was like tan, blue, gray.
Oh,
all right, I'll take the green.
It was ridiculous.
A little bit of color.
Yeah. I was like, well, congratulations on your fucking choosing skills. They're exceptional. Oh gosh.
But I do think depression and anxiety is something that everyone deals with.
I don't think so at all. There are a lot of people out there that have normal brains.
And I'm like jealous.
So maybe not.
Everybody gets sad.
Maybe not the depression part.
And everybody gets a little overwhelmed.
I don't think so.
I don't think everybody has anxiety and depression. I think we just know so many people in our lives that struggle with these things, but that's because crazy attracts crazy. I don't know if you guys notice that or not, but if you notice that all your friends are nuts, take a look in the mirror.
We're all perfectly sane.
Everybody is dealing with something all the time. Whether it be a huge issue or a small issue, like I think people see things differently.
Yeah, some people are just dealing with being narcissists. They don't have anxiety. They don't have depression. But they do have a shitty ass attitude.
Maybe they don't
want to be around.
Maybe they have that shitty ass attitude because they're masking to try to hide their depression.
Like a lot of narcissists don't want to be a narcissist. Like the ones that acknowledge their behavior and how they treat others.
They probably have anxiety over that.
Yeah, I guess, yeah, turn around, turn tables, turn.
So I feel like everybody has anxiety over something.
I don't think anybody is skating through this world footloose and fancy free. I think the way that I feel when I get anxiety and when I have like an actual anxiety attack, like not everybody is feeling that way.
It's like whenever people that have like the physical anxiety and we say, oh, we have anxiety, because we are saying we clinically have it.
Like I get
versus I remember what it was like to be anxious and nervous for something that someone would say, oh, that's like your anxiety. No, that's just like my adrenaline kind of hyping for the situation that was a normal anxiety still functioning. Then whenever it altered to a shut down anxiety to where like the same situation instead of just being normal butterflies.
Like everybody gets that feeling where they're like, ooh, you know what I mean? Like everybody gets a little anxiety over things. Everybody gets a little, but there's a big difference between like medical and just like regular. That's what I'm saying is like, yes, that feeling of like anxiousness on a small scale is absolutely within everybody
that's how our bodies work.
But not everybody has anxiety.
See, I think everybody has anxiety, but there can be different levels of it.
Yeah, but I guess in the fucked up as the world is, I don't know. Maybe they just make it look easier, you know?
That's a big thing. I think people definitely handle things differently.
I think people
find things to help them with their anxiety.
Yeah.
But I think just because you can't tell, just because it doesn't seem like someone
I think a lot of people claim to have anxiety because it's like tortured artistness.
I think a big part of it is you don't know how to describe exactly how you're feeling.
Thank you to BetterHelp for sponsoring this episode. BetterHelp is the world's largest therapy service, and it's 100% online. With BetterHelp, you can tap into a network of over 30,000 licensed and experienced therapists who can help you with a wide range of issues. To get started, you just answer a few questions about your needs and preferences in therapy. That way, BetterHelp can match you with the right therapist from their network. Then you can talk to your therapist however you feel comfortable, whether it's via text, chat, phone, or video call. You can message your therapist at any time and schedule live sessions when it's convenient for you. If your therapist isn't the right fit for any reason, you can switch to a new therapist at no additional charge. With BetterHelp, you get the same professionalism and quality you expect from in-office therapy, but with a therapist who is custom-picked for you, more scheduling flexibility, and at a more affordable price. Get 10% off your first month at betterhelp.com/thebarn. That's betterhelp.com/thebarn. This episode is brought to you by Copper Fox Contrived, located at 361 West Main Street, Park Hills, Missouri. Handmade gifts and wood flowers.
This is Tippy.
And this is Jo.
And you're listening to the Tippy Jo Show, sponsored by BetterHelp.com/thebarn. If it's all right.